الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. وبعد، we continue with our Tarbiyah series, and inshallah, we'll talk today about the things relating to praying in Jama'ah, especially the things that we should avoid. The first thing to remember in praying in Jama'ah is the formation of the saf. The formation of the saf is one of the principles of the establishment of Salah, and therefore it's very important for us to take a lot of care and in forming of the saf. Forming of the saf is two things. One is to align all the heels. The formation of the saf is by the heels, not by the toes. So ensure that all the heels are in line, one line. And the second one is to stand shoulder to shoulder, actually touching the shoulder of the person next to you. After the shoulder touches, then the issue of the feet. And the feet also should touch. If the feet don't touch also, if they are nearby, that's enough, inshallah. We find sometimes people go to extremes in everything. And the way they go to extremes is they stand, first of all, with their feet wide apart. So there's no way the shoulder can touch, because if your feet are wide apart, how is the shoulder going to touch? And then on top of that, in their attempt or enthusiasm to touch the foot of the other person, they stamp on the foot of the other person, which is highly irritating. And it obviously the other person objects. So very important not to do all that. Just make sure you stand shoulder to shoulder. That's the formation of the saf. Second thing about saf is that the gaps in the saf must be filled. So if you are forming the saf, if you have come to the masjid and you are getting into the second saf, make sure that you look at the first saf and fill the gap in the first saf before you start forming a second saf. And the same thing applies to the third and the fourth, and so on. So ensure that there is no gap in the saf in front of you. If it's a long saf, if you need to walk to one end to ensure that you fill the gap, you do that. You don't just stand, you know, out of laziness in one place and the sufuf are incomplete. Make sure you do that. Second thing is that if, for example, happens in Taraweeh quite often, that the salah starts and at that time somebody in the saf decides to go away. So now to begin with, it was a complete saf, now you got a gap. If the gap happens, then you must move, in your salah, you must move and fill the gap, not leave the gap open. That's very important to do that. Nothing happens to your salah is valid, but you must move and close the gap. Or draw the other person close to you, whichever is convenient. Now obviously, it's important to educate people, because sometimes if you try to draw the other person, then he won't come. And then you're tug of war in the, obviously that is not good for your salah. So ensure that, you move and ensure that the saf is completed. Third thing is, if you come into the masjid and you find that the saf is completed, you are alone and you have to start a new saf. If you are sure that there are a couple, for example, you might have come out of the wudu place and there are another 2-3 people making wudu there. So you know that in, you know, a minute or two, those people are also going to come and join you. So in which case, the starting of the saf is always from behind the imam. So the center of the saf. So don't start the saf on one corner, behind the imam, and then the saf must expand equally both ways. So if people come, don't just keep standing to the right or to the left. Ensure that there is the saf is evenly distributed behind the imam. So if you come now and you stand behind the imam and you find that and you know that there are a couple of other people who are going to come just now, then there's no problem. You can stand there, they will come and join you. But if you are not sure of that and you are alone, then do not stand in a saf alone. So what you must do is tap the person in front of you, the whichever saf it is, and that person will move back and stand with you, and this saf must close. Right? A friend of mine told me that in Saudi Arabia, he came and the saf was completed, first saf, and he came in the second saf and he stood there, and then he tapped the guy on the shoulder, so he moved back and this fellow moved in front and stood in his place. Yeah? And that is very bad. Huh? You should not do that. Right? Comedy, both of them is like a comedy. Yeah? No, don't do it. Make sure that the saf is, you must not stand alone in the saf. Make sure that somebody is there. So tap him on the shoulder, he will move back and he stand with you and the saf must close. Right? Then second issue is moving in salah, when you are standing in salah. Now some people, if you look at them, you don't know, is he in salah or is he not in salah? And with Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, if that is the situation, where somebody looking at you from outside, if he cannot decide whether you are in salah or not, then your salah is invalid. Then you have to repeat your salah. So, you know, moving too much, you're scratching your head or whatever, God knows what you're doing. So, thing is that, you must stand still. With the Sahaba, as we know, they used to say that the Sahaba would stand as if there is a bird which is perched on their head. So if they move even a little bit, the bird will fly away. You know, they used to stand like that, as if they had been like pegs in the ground. They had been, you know, established like pillars. So it was very important. Stand, do all your scratching and whatever before you make your rakat. And after that, stand. You know, forget the scratching. Just stand in salah. Don't keep moving and scratching and adjusting your clothes and, you know, subhanAllah. And also don't wear clothes that require a lot of adjustment. I mean, in this, yeah, that's another big nuisance. Yeah? Sometimes people, they wear a ghotra. Now they don't know what to do with the ghotra. And they don't have a nigal on top of that. So that thing keeps slipping and you keep pulling it. And the whole time now you are engaged in this ghotra. Allah, Allah, ghotra. Do your salah, man. Let it fall away. What does it matter if it falls? So, ensure that there is no unnecessary movement in salah. It is, and as I told you, depending on how much movement you did and what, it can completely invalidate your salah. Your salah is not valid at all. You have to repeat your salah. So, don't fall into that trap. Then the issue also of personal hygiene. And we experience this more in Ramadan. Please understand the hadith where Rasulullah said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes the smell of that comes from the mouth of the fasting person more than the smell of musk, refers to the smell that comes as a result of an empty stomach. It does not refer to the smell that comes out of a filthy mouth. Right? Personal hygiene is very important. Please brush your teeth. As simple as that, right? So, you are in sujood, and especially, you know, in qiyamul layl, long sajda, and subhanAllah, you want to, please, Imam, please wake up, get up, you know, I can't stay in the sajda anymore, I will die because this guy next to me is stinking. Please, don't do that. Brush your teeth, right? Brush your teeth after your suhoor, brush your teeth after your iftar, inshallah, that should be enough. During the day, if you want to brush your teeth, use a miswak, use a toothbrush without toothpaste if you want. There is an opinion also that you can use toothpaste, whichever opinion you want to use, but make sure you clean your mouth. There is nothing nice about a filthy mouth. It's bad for you, bad for your teeth, bad for everybody else. Third thing about on the same context is the issue of belching. Believe me, the guy standing next to you does not want to know what you had for iftar. Right? He doesn't want to know whether your halim came from, what is that? Pista house or some other place. Right? Brush your teeth. Do not belch. There is a hadith. A man was belching with Rasulullah ﷺ and he was praying, and Rasulullah ﷺ told him, "This is disgusting." He said, "This, you are doing this because you ate too much food." So he said, "Eat less." Right? So do not belch. And if you have to belch, then at least put your hand in the front of your mouth. I mean, you have to cover your mouth. Right? Why must you? People, they sound like a tiger roaring. And it smells also like the tiger roaring. I was in South Africa, they took us to this lion park, and there's this, you know, this guy who handles lions and so on, there's a, you are in a truck with a mesh and so on. And this guy does this trick. He takes a piece of meat on a stick, and he puts it up there, and as you are standing there, and the lion comes up, you know, and he takes this piece of meat, and obviously the lion makes a noise, "Arr!" And the stink from a lion's mouth. And the man says, that is the last thing you will smell before the lion eats you. So, right? Now, we don't want this, right? You do not want lions in your salah. You want human beings. So, do not belch. If it is some problem you have got, then at least cover your mouth. It is very, very important, highly disgusting to find people, you know, belching and so on. Also, same thing applies to body odor. Some people have a natural body odor. It might sound might seem very aromatic to you. It is not to others. Use deodorant, right? See, I tell you, I told you, I told people, you know, I'm like, do I look like your mother? Because me, I've got to teach people in this masjid how to sneeze, right? La hawla quwwata illa. How many of you got mothers with full beards, huh? So again, we come to the issue of sneezing. If you have to sneeze, cover your mouth. Do not spray, you know, all over the masjid. La hawla quwwata illa. The stuff comes out of your nose at 150 miles an hour. It's not funny. And especially air-conditioned masajid, it means now that virus is circulating in the atmosphere forever, and everybody else is going to get sick. Cover your mouth, please. You know, do it with tissue, with your topi maybe, or Allah know what, right? So do it. Make sure that you do not cause inconvenience. Rasulullah ﷺ prohibited free people from coming into the masjid after having eaten onions and garlic. And he said, the malaika do not like the smell of that. They find it disgusting. But here you have onion, garlic, and every masala in the world, you know, which also comes out of this. Please, very important for us. Oral hygiene, very important. Also, feet. Right? What is it called? Toe jam, huh? Dirty socks. Right? So it's disgusting to do sujood. Alhamdulillah, we don't have it here in this masjid, but I've done sajda in the place is the place of sajda is stinking because somebody was standing there with dirty feet. Don't do that. I mean, wash your feet, wash your socks. Cleanliness is part of Islam. Cleanliness is very much part of Islam. So let us be very sure that we are clean. If you can't be clean in the house of Allah, where will you be clean? Right? Very important for us. Let us maintain these issues of personal hygiene. It's an issue of our own salah. It's an issue of the salah of other people. Then the last and final one. I even demonstrated the strokes of the Aikido sword, right? As the guy he takes off two heads in one stroke. That's what should happen to people who do not turn their phones off. Yes? What is this thing about phones? I don't understand. You tell people a million times, still a phone will ring. Why? I mean, what is this thing about phones? Turn it off, do something. Yesterday, one brother came to me. He said, please allow me to put jammers in this masjid. So I said, please go ahead, do it. Put jammers. That's the best thing. You put jammers, end of the story, we turn the jammer on and your phone won't ring forever. I mean, you know, why must all this happen? Turn the phone off. Simple as that, right? The world will not come to a halt. If it comes to a halt, that is good. The way the world is going, it can do with coming to a halt. Right? So, turn the phones off. It's very, very bad for us to have these phones ringing and so on and so on. And then on top of that, some people, I don't know which mazhab they are following, some phony mazhab. Yeah? So, because the phone rings and they don't turn it off and they just rings and rings and rings and rings and rings. And then the man says, no, my salah, your salah, you ruined everybody else's salah. I mean, you know, what about that? Right? So at least turn it off. And just turn it off before you come into masjid. I mean, nothing. And if, for example, if you've got some kind of phone which even if you turn it off, it still rings or whatever, or it beeps or something, leave it in your car, leave it in your house, do whatever it is, you know. After all, how much time even in Taraweeh. In our masjid, the Taraweeh is probably longer than most, it takes probably longer than most places because we read slowly. Even with everything from the beginning of Fard Salah to the end of Taraweeh and everything else takes 2 hours. So what's going to happen to the world in 2 hours? So please, turn phones off. Do not, ideally don't even bring it into the masjid. If you have to bring it, turn it off. Do not have this thing of phones ringing again and again, and people have to tell you over and over. And how many times to tell the same thing over and again? It's, you feel bad telling these things. Like Hafiz Bhai was telling me, how many things to teach? And he told me something else which I don't want to repeat here, to teach. Please, let us not, So let us be very clear. Let us not do these things. Ensure that the salah is a beautiful experience for yourself and for other people. Very important. Last thing, and this is not from the Tarbiyah series, but because somebody asked me, the issue of moonsighting and who do you follow? The opinion is from all the mazahib that you follow the people in the country in which you are living. So supposing you say, well, I started fasting in Saudi Arabia, but now I'm in India or I'm in America or somewhere, and the Eid in Saudi Arabia is one day earlier. When do I do Eid? You do Eid with the people where you are staying. And if you have fasted one extra day, inshallah, that's enough will fast for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you a reward for that. There's nothing to worry about, but you stay with that. The best opinion that I have read in terms of this is the opinion of Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen rahmatullah alayhi, who said the simplest way of understanding this. He said, who do you follow in Salah? When do you pray Salatul Fajr? When it is Fajr in your country or when it is Fajr in the Haram? Simplest, that's a very easy way to understand. So the daily Salawat is followed, that's the sun, and the monthly thing is the moon. So he said, you follow wherever you are, you pray Fajr when it is Fajr. You don't pray Fajr when it is Fajr in Saudi Arabia, right? So, same thing applies also to the Eid and to the beginning of Ramadan and to the end of Ramadan. The Hadith of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is very clear that you see the moon and start fasting, and you see the moon and stop fasting, and if you cannot see the moon, complete 30 days. To see the moon means to actually see it. Now, whether you can, you know, use maybe binoculars or a telescope or something, but you have to actually see the moon. And if it is cloudy, then maybe you can go up in a helicopter or something and see the moon. That's all of this is permissible. But what is not permissible is to do astronomical calculations. Where you have not seen the moon and you just do this mathematical calculation and you've got this calendar for the next 500 years and you say Eid will be on so and so date. Why? Because my calculation tells me that. This is not permissible. The Hadith of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is very clear. Why must we go into, you know, confuse ourselves and complicate life for what? Follow the Hadith. If you didn't see the moon, no problem. Just fast one extra day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you that much more reward and so on and so forth. What is the problem? So there is no need to get confused, no need to get needlessly into arguments and whatnot. If you see the moon, alhamdulillah, we will break the fast and we have Eid. And if the moon is not sighted, alhamdulillah, we have one additional day of Ramadan. What more can we ask? We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gave us one additional day of Ramadan. So no need to get confused and, you know, all of these things with regard to the sighting of the moon. Right? What else? Did I miss anything in this? Ji? Yeah. How to use the bathrooms? If you are using an English style toilet, lower the seat, which is a round thing with a hole in it, right? And then remove your trousers, and then sit on it. Don't climb on top of that with your feet. Sit on it with your bottom, and then there will be a report and a deposit will be made, right? La hawla wala quwwata. What else? Please clean the idea of toilets is to, you must keep the toilet clean. I always say, I don't say leave the toilet as you found it, because you probably found it in a lousy condition. So no, leave it better than you found it, right? Clean. Let me make one thing very clear. Azhar is going and turning off the recording and what not. That's what. He gets very anxious. He says, what people do these things, somebody has to teach them, no? What to do. So there's nothing to be ashamed of. See, let me tell you one thing. Khidmat to the house of Allah. As the people say, if you read the Quran, you get thawab. You do khidmat, you get Allah. Right? Khidmat to the house of Allah is a matter of honor for ourselves. It's not something that we should stay away from or we should feel bad about. We should volunteer for this. We should volunteer for this. One of the great ulama of this country, Maulana Siddiq Bandwi rahmatullah alayh, is a wonderful story that Maulana Rashid Naseem Nadwi, the sheikh who yesterday whose lecture was in this masjid, he told me a fantastic story. He said that one of his friends from Nadwa, and he and a few of them, they had gone to Banda, where the madrasa of Maulana Siddiq Bandwi is, and that's a place to see and shows one, you know, how dedicated this ulama are and how much they are willing to sacrifice. Maulana Siddiq Bandwi Ramatullahi went and started a madrasa there. This is in the Chambal Valley, place which was known for highway robberies, right? And it's the middle of the forest, middle of nowhere. And that's where he started his madrasa. And today, of course, it's a big madrasa. So these people went to visit him. And this man says that, I was very surprised that the toilets of this madrasa were absolutely spotlessly clean. So he said, when I used to wake up to go to the toilet before Salat al-Fajr to prepare for that, I go to the toilet, it's washed and absolutely, you know, sparkling clean, which is highly unusual. So it's very, very unusual. How come these toilets are so clean at this time of the morning? So this man said, he really got so intrigued with this thing. He said, I must get to the bottom of this mystery. What happens? And he said, I actually sat up and waited to see what happens. And he said, what did he see? He says, 2 o'clock in the morning, he sees Maulana Siddiq Bandwi Rahmatullah Alayh get up, go and clean all the toilets, not one, cleaning all the toilets, washing all the toilets, then he would take a shower, he would take a bath, and then he would come and do his Salat Tahajjud. This is the alim of, he's Hafiz, alim, he is the Nazim, he is the director of that madrasa. He cleans the toilets himself. We must understand, we must learn from the elders. What is the meaning of the khidmat of this deen? Right? So cleaning a masjid, cleaning the toilets, doing things is something which is very much something that we should volunteer to do. And that's why, you know, irrespective of what people, I know some people have different views about Jamaat Tabligh, but I strongly recommend that everybody goes in Jamaat. Go at least for a 1 month Jamaat. Then you will learn all of these adab. وصلى الله على نبي الكريم وعليه وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين
إن الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه وبعد on the subject of adab of the masjid, I think it's very important for us to learn these adab and to teach them to our children. It appears that today the big culprits are the parents, not so much the children. Children do what they see their parents doing, they see what the parents teach them. So it's very important for the elders to learn how to behave in a masjid. Number one very important rule, the masjid is primarily and only, if not only, then definitely primarily for the worship of Allah alone. And I'm saying only, not only, because it is also for teaching and learning about Islam, which, as we know, is also another way of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the purpose of the masjid is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it's in the form of formal salah, whether it's in the form of listening to a khutbah, whether it's in the form of attending a lecture or a class. And therefore, the decorum of the masjid must be maintained. When we do not maintain the decorum of the masjid, we are committing a crime against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the disrespect that is shown in a masjid is not shown to the imam, it is not shown to the musallis, it is shown to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The masjid is not the house of the imam, the masjid is not the house of the musalli, the masjid is the house of Allah. So if someone behaves in a masjid in a way which is disrespectful, then he is disrespecting Allah, and then therefore let him be prepared for the consequences of disrespecting Allah. So therefore, first rule in the masjid, as far as respect is concerned, is to maintain silence. Is not to speak except and unless it is to it is in connection with the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one. Number two is not to speak in the masjid about anything to do with the dunya. No business deals and no networking and no talking on talking about things other than Islam and other than the work of Allah. Third thing is telephones must be on silent. Phones must not ring. If they ring, they should not be answered. If you want to answer the phone, leave the masjid, go outside and answer the phone, not inside the masjid. Don't answer phones inside the masjid, don't have them ring. Best thing in the world is do not even bring the phone into the masjid. Leave it in your car, leave it in your home. There's no need to bring it inside the masjid in the first place, and if you bring it in the masjid, then all this evil starts. Best thing is leave it in the car. When you go back to your car, then you can pick up all your missed calls. After all, you're not spending spending hours and hours in the masjid. Most of us do not spend more than a few minutes, maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, and the world will not come to a halt in that 20 minutes, believe me. So therefore, just leave the phone outside the masjid. Leave it in your car, leave it in your home or wherever it is, but do not even bring it to the masjid. If you bring it, ensure it is silent. Ensure it is switched off. Let it not ring at all in the first place. And if you happen to be in a situation where you forgot and the phone rings, even if it is during salah, turn it off. Then even if you have to break your salah and turn it off, break your salah and turn it off, but do not let the phone ring. If you just turn it off in your salah, the salah doesn't break. So no fear of that, but do not let the phone ring, because it disturbs everybody else and spoils their salah, and that is a worse crime than moving to turn the phone off. So do not allow the phone to ring. Fourth thing, never run in a masjid. Walk with dignity, walk with waqar. Dignity is seems to have been, you know, we've removed it from our lexicon. I mean, amazing how people behave in ways which are more close to the behavior of animals than to the behavior of human beings. So let us try to be dignified, right? Make an effort. It's possible, believe me. Behave in a dignified manner, walk with dignity, don't run to catch a rakat. There is no need, the salah is not going anywhere. If you miss one rakat, you catch the next one. Second, third, the other matter is, once you reach the jama'ah, make your niyyah, make takbir tahima, and join the imam and the jama'ah in whichever position they are in. Many times you see people, the jama'ah is in sujood, and you see somebody who's just standing there waiting for them to finish their sajda. Maybe that sajda is the sajda in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed your own forgiveness, and you miss that sajda. Don't wait for the sajda to finish. Don't wait for to see if the imam will stand up or not. Whatever position the jamaat is in, join them in that position. So if they are in sujood, you go into sajda. There is nothing wrong in making sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believe me. So as soon as you go there, make takbir, and then go into whichever position, join the position of the imam, and then continue the salah from that position. The other issue with the masjid is, especially in Jummah, during the khutbah, it is not permissible to talk. It is not permissible to unnecessarily, it's not permissible even during the khutbah to read the Quran or to make tasbih or something. All of these actions are disliked during that particular point in time. So even if you are reading Quran, once the khutbah starts, put the Quran away. Put your tasbih away and pay attention, listen to the khutbah. In many masajids, we have the practice of the talk, a lecture before the khutbah. Obviously, that lecture is not in English, it's not in Arabic, it's in some other language, and that lecture does not have the same level as the khutbah. But then the lecture also does not have the level of a TV program, it doesn't have the level of some khurafat that you do at home. It is a religious talk. It is something which must be respected, where you must sit silently, listen to it. Maybe there is some good for you in that. If you don't want to listen to it, then the best option is, do not even enter the masjid, stay outside. Once that talk is over, then come and join for the Arabic khutbah, no problem. There's no compulsion on you. But if you come inside the masjid and lecture is going on in whichever language it is, then it is highly disrespectful of the masjid for you to do something else, or to talk, or to disturb the people who are listening to the khutbah. Do not do that. I mean, there should be no need to say all these things, because and this is the whole issue of upbringing of children. The parents are supposed to teach all this at home, but since parents don't seem to do that, therefore it's necessary to speak about these things in the masjid. Alhamdulillah, let us get some hidayat from wherever it is coming. So do not disrupt the peace of the masjid. As I said, the masjid is the house of Allah. It is not the house of the imam, it's not your house, it's not my house, it's the house of Allah. And therefore, if you misbehave there, then you're misbehaving with regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as I said, if you want to do that, then you are responsible for the consequences. So do not tempt the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't think that's something that we really should take any chances with. In terms of the adab of the masjid, it's very important for us also to teach our children all of these things. The salah, we have to must stand absolutely still, not fidget around, not move around, no unnecessary movements in salah. So let us make sure that we follow these rules of the masjid, so that we don't violate them, and then we ensure that our salah is accepted and our du'as are accepted, and that our masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are respected, that they are kept clean, and they are maintained the way they should be maintained. And as Allah said in the Quran, the masajid of Allah can only be maintained by people of taqwa. So this is a measure of our own taqwa as well. Last point, the facilities in the masjid, the lighting, the air conditioning, the bathrooms, all these are meant for us, alhamdulillah, and therefore we need to take care of them. Very often we see people who will enter the bathroom, turn on the lights, and when they finish, they just walk away. Now, who is supposed to turn the lights off? The imam or somebody else? So the basic rule to follow is, if you turned it on, you turn it off. If you didn't turn it on, if you found it on, turn it off. That applies to the lights, that applies to air conditioning. Many times you find people, they enter the masjid, they will turn on every light in the masjid. They turn on all the switches. They just turn a switch on because it's there. That's ridiculous, you know. You just turn on as much as you need. The rest of it, leave it off. And when you finish, turn it off and go. Do not abuse the facilities in the masjid. As I said, it's the house of Allah. So watch out. Don't play games with the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ensure that the lights are off. Ensure the taps are off. That no water is leaking. Ensure that the place is clean. The bathrooms. Ensure that the bathroom is... it's just called a bathroom, right? It's just not because you need to have a bath in it. We find people in the bathroom, the toilet, the entire place is flooded because somebody's been washing their feet in the toilet, using the shower inside the toilet. That's meant for some other part of your body, not for your feet. So please, how many things are we supposed to teach? You want us to teach people even how to wash themselves in the toilet? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. I mean, seriously, let us behave like civilized people and ensure that we do not abuse the facilities that are meant for us in the masjid and use them in the best possible manner. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for us to do that which is pleasing to Him, and to save us from actions which are displeasing to Him, because those actions only harm us and nobody else. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil kareem wa alihi wa sahbihi ajmain bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.